Okay, our next guest. Well, it's hard to believe, but next month marks the 10th anniversary of 9/11. My next guest has a very special connection to that day. He left Donegal as a very young man and ended up as a commanding officer in the New York Police Department. He got caught up in the 9/11 attacks, and he's about to launch an exhibition here in Ireland to commemorate that occasion. Please give a very warm welcome to Paul McCormack. Well, I was asking people today, I mean, most people know where they were when they saw what was happening to the Twin Towers. Where were you on that day?
I was actually on my way to Fordham University on the morning of to teach a class for the NYPD. And I heard it over the radio on my way that a plane had hit one of the towers. And at the time, we didn't know what type of... It wasn't like a really big story at the time because you didn't know, was it a small plane? But when the second plane hit, and what we were getting reports coming in as well, as a precinct commander at the time, we were getting a lot, and my phone was going off the hook because there was a lot of debris falling from the first plane hitting, and there was a lot of reports coming in. But once the second plane hit, all hell broke loose, and it was chaos for a long time after that.
And what did you do then?
I went to my precinct. I was the commanding officer of the 41st Precinct, which is Fort Apache, and basically there was a mass mobilization. We knew there was a terror attack, and there was a lot of information, misinformation, and rumors coming in, and it was hard to know like what was going on. So we were worried about other, you know, very high profile locations going to get hit, because we had rumors that the White House had been hit. I mean, we knew the Pentagon had been hit, and there were so many rumors coming in about vans going around loaded with bombs, and every bridge and tunnel was a possible target. So we had to do probably the largest mobilization in the history of the NYPD, and it was all hands on deck. We had to get everybody in, and as precinct commanders, we were responsible to get our 150 to 250 men and women into work, to get the job done and get as much help as possible.
And Sadie, you lost colleagues, didn't you?
Yes, I mean, I'm sure everybody, you speak to a lot of people, and everybody knows people that, they heard of people, from Donegal, and the Meehan family. I was very close to Damien Meehan. I played on the New York minor team with him, and Damien, he's got brothers that are police and firemen, and Damien died, and I was the commanding officer of the 13th Precinct, and we lost two police officers from the 13th Precinct, Moira Smith and Bobby Fazio. And speaking of Moira, Moira's father was a dub. He was John Joe Reddy. He was born in Coombe Hospital in 1927. And of course, the dubs claim Moira as their own right now. And Moira was an unbelievable hero of 9/11. She was the only female from the NYPD that was killed in 9/11. And she's a really inspiring person. And we're honoring her here at the exhibition here, Miriam.
We have that's her medal, is that
correct?
Yeah,
that's the medal of honor that she received posthumously. Her daughter, Patricia, was a very moving ceremony at the One Police Plaza in November when the medals were given out to the police officers that were killed. It was 23 NYPD officers killed. And as I said, Moira was the only female killed. And that's her daughter, Patricia, who was 2 years old at the time, walked across the stage at One Police Plaza and accepted that medal. And her husband, Jimmy, is also a police officer. Jimmy's retired now, but Jimmy was a cop in the 13th as well. And Jimmy graciously gave us this medal. He gave us Moira's hat and her radio. And one of the very, very, sad things that happened on the day, Miriam, was, when we were listening to our citywide radio frequency, when the second tower fell, we heard a female come over the radio calling for help. And we later found out that was Moira. And part of our exhibition, we do have the audio from the day from the police department, and we have Moira's last words. And it's, again, Jimmy graciously gave us Moira's radio for the exhibition as well. And we're really honored to be honoring Moira at the exhibition.
It must be so distressing to listen to that audio. Did you find it difficult?
I found it very difficult on the day because as a cop, there's nothing worse than hearing one of your own calling for help on a radio and not being able to do anything about it. It's a very disturbing feeling. And I didn't hear the audio for a long time. I only heard it about 4 or 5 months ago for the first time since 9/11. And it just brought it all back. It's a really, it's just, makes the hair stand on the back of your neck listening to it again. And it's unbelievable, really. And not just Moira's call, but the chatter that was going on from the police officers, you could feel the, you know, the fear and the anguish of the whole event and all of the radio calls of the day.
God. And this cross here, now we all know this is the iconic huge cross that came from the metal, which I know is in New York. Tell me about this here. It's also going to be in the exhibition, Paul.
Yeah, the iron workers that poured down upon Ground Zero were I always call them the unsung heroes of the day. They were unbelievable, the work the iron workers did. And they came in from all over the country, but the New York locals, my brother was a member of Local 580, the New York City iron workers, and you can see how thick this steel is. Yeah. It's a really heavy piece of steel, but they cut some crosses out of the steel and they gave them to us for the exhibition. So it's unbelievable, and as I said, they did tremendous work on the day, and my hat's off to the iron workers. They worked side by side with the firefighters and the police officers in the rescue and recovery, and it's hard to explain the danger that was down there, but they were unbelievable, climbing up on mounds of moving steel, and they had to cut the steel so we could get in and do what we had to do. So my hat's off to the iron workers.
And amazingly, your wife's a photographer, right, Nicola? I know she's with us in the audience here. I think she is there anyway. We'll catch her in a moment. And she took photographs, actually, on the day. And they're going to be at the exhibition. Will you talk me through these,
first of all? Well, my wife, Nicola, is a brilliant photographer. And she was in shortly after the second tower fell, and she took a lot of amazing shots. I mean, I didn't see them until, again, 4 or 5 months ago. And when she took the pictures originally, she put them in a tin box and didn't open them up to 2 years ago. And if you want to go through the shots here, Miriam, they're actually amazing shots. I mean, I like the shot of myself, of course, here with the rubble in the background. But we didn't know what was going on. As I said, there was so much misinformation going on. And that first photo is of me down at Ground Zero. And as a precinct commander from the Bronx, we were put in charge of the frozen area security. There was a fence put up in a 10-block radius. It's the frozen zone started off on 14th Street from river to river, and that was on the first day. But as we got a grip on things, we tightened that up to a 10-block radius, and there was basically a mesh wire fence put up around the radius of Ground Zero, and we were responsible for the security of it.
And the next one there, Paul?
That's the Wall Street station with the shoes. I mean, somebody got blown out of their shoes by the impact, basically, with that there. And with Wall Street, I mean, the financial district got hit, the World Trade Center, and I remember being at Wall Street for the opening about 5 days later, and it was a really emotional day to get the for New York City and for the financial, because the financial world crashed for a while there, but it was a really moving time down at the stock exchange.
On the next one there, Paul?
That's a bunch of firefighters that are walking up. This picture was taken a couple hours after the second tower fell. And I don't know if you can see the anguish on their face. These guys have realized right now that they have lost a lot of their friends. And there was 343 firefighters killed on 9/11. And by the way, one of the other people we're honoring in our exhibition is firefighter Kevin O'Rourke, whose mother's from County Monaghan. And another inspiring hero. And they're all heroes. I mean, there's 343 of them. The fire department had a tremendous loss on that day. And you can see the anguish on their faces because they know that they've lost a lot of friends.
And the next one there, Paul, I can see them on my screen in front.
Okay.
That's why I don't even
That's
know.
Two police officers. That, again, that's just shortly after the second tower fell. And Nicola, when she took that picture, you can see the guy on the right there. He's got his hand on his gun. Right, shortly after that picture was taken, he actually took his gun out and he had to identify Nicola and scared her a little bit. Actually, something I've wanted to do a couple of times since then is take my gun out of her a few times. But you can see the fear on their face as well. This picture here, I mean, flags went up after 9/11. Like, I can tell you this, as a New Yorker and as an American, I have never felt so American as I did after that incident happened. And not only in this building, but the flags went up everywhere. Every family, every house had a flag flying. And you come across the George Washington Bridge, one of the biggest flags I've ever seen. I don't even know how they got it up there, but everybody had a flag, and this is a brilliant picture here, but it catches the feel of patriotism that we had. We were so proud to be New Yorkers. The country came together in a way that's hard to describe, and everybody felt united as Americans, and it's a feeling you rarely get in life. And I can tell you, America, you've got Democrats and Republicans and politics, and they want to kill each other, but there was no fighting. It was a unified country at the time, and it was a fleeting moment for that, but you know, it was a great feeling at the time.
And it's fascinating to hear you say it like that, because I suppose you're a Donegal man who ended up out there.
Yeah.
And yet, when you were there, did you regard yourself American? And was there a great camaraderie between Irish-Americans at that time?
Well, I'm very proud to be Donegal. And by the way, I know the Dubs won tonight, but we will take care of them at the end of the month. But I'm a proud Donegalman, but I've spent most of my life in New York. When did you go there?
I went there
in 86. It was, the economy was shot. It was like now.
Yeah.
But we didn't have anything. It was emigrate. And unfortunately for me, I was born in America, so I had my American passport, and it was emigrate or go on the dole. And I emigrated and I went to New York, and I got lucky. I got into the police department. There was no height restriction in New York. I was too short to be a guard here. I was 5'7". But I joined the police in 1990, did 20 years, and I retired last year. So I was really proud of my career. I love the NYPD. It's a magnificent police department, and I'm proud to say I was a member of it.
And it's sweet that you've come home to live in Donegal, haven't you, with Nick? Oh, you've come home to Ireland.
I come home to Ireland, living in Dublin with my beautiful wife, Nicola, and my four wonderful kids who are probably up watching this right now.
Excellent.
I just want to tell them, Polly, Mac, James, Mikey, and Bobby D, you're going to bed after Miriam tonight. It'd be good for your granny, Jean.
There they are, yeah.
Okay.
But, I mean, I suppose it's astonishing to have been there on 9/11, and I know this exhibition is going to happen. Tell us when it's going to take place.
The exhibition is on August 17th, Wednesday, August 17th, at Collins Barracks at the National Museum. And anybody that wants to follow us, by the way, they can go onto our Facebook at Ground 0360 or our website, ground0360.org. Nicholas come out with a wonderful book with all our images that can be got online, and it's a brilliant exhibition. We're very proud. The goal of our exhibition is to keep the memory alive and never forget the sacrifice of so many on that day. And I'm damn proud to be part of this. And I'm very proud of what Nicola has produced here. It's unbelievable. And the response we get from the families that are involved, because we're doing this in Chicago as well, and we have firefighters and police officers involved in there, and we've got a lot of victims that are associated with this project, and it's inspiring when you speak to them, Miriam. It really is, because they are. They get very emotional over it, and they're proud to be part of it. And I will say that with the Smith family, Jimmy and Patricia are coming over, and I think half of the O'Rourkes from Monaghan are coming down for the event as well. So we're really looking forward to it.
Well, look, Paul, thank you very much for coming in tonight and sharing with us. And well done to you for all you did on that time in 9/11. Thank you very much, Paul.
Thank you for having me, Miriam.
Yeah, very welcome. My pleasure. Okay, coming up after the break, Miss Ireland, a comedian and a legendary show band star, get a few lessons in country pursuits. Join us in a few moments. Thank you.